Hello, colleagues, and a very warm welcome. I'm Catherine Cox, an analyst in London and a member of the organising committee. An especially warm welcome to our Ukrainian colleagues, who of course have a very special place in all our hearts and minds. If it's your first time of joining one of our webinars, we welcome you. And if you're a returning participant, it's really good to have you with us again. Before I introduce you to our chair for today, just a couple of announcements. If you haven't already done so, please now select the language in which you would like to hear the proceedings. This includes if you would like to hear English. You will need to click on the globe icon, which if you are on a laptop, will be at the bottom of your screen. If you can't find it, please look for the three dots and click on them. Today, we have translation into Ukrainian, of course, Spanish, Italian, Portuguese, German, but sadly no French. I do, however, have some exciting news. For the first time, we will be having simultaneous translation into Chinese. We warmly welcome Bingling and Angeline Hong Lu to our wonderful team of interpreters. Thank you for joining us. And thank you to all our interpreters who work so hard, free of charge, in order to support Ukraine. Your generosity and expertise are very much appreciated. We do, of course, pay our Ukrainian interpreters, I should just say. So thanks to Bing, Angeline, and also Wordly Wise, who mastermind the interpretation side of things for us, also without charge, I am now with great pleasure able also to extend a very warm welcome to our colleagues in Taiwan and China. They probably aren't actually in the room with us at the moment as it's the middle of the night for them, but they will be able to join us via the recording, which is now underway. So to all our colleagues in Taiwan and China, we are delighted to have you with us, and we very much look forward to your future participation. Now, just a quick tip from Sanctus Media, who are running the production side for us today, as they always do. Sanctus Media will spotlight speakers so that you can easily see them. So I'm spotlit at the moment. However, this is a community event, and it's very nice, I think, occasionally to scroll through and to see one another. And you can still do this if you switch to the gallery view. And then when you switch back to speaker view, you'll be back to the spotlit speaker. So a quick run through what to expect today. After our chair, Catherine Hines, has spoken, Olena Brante will give her presentation, which will be about 35 minutes. We will then have a 5-minute comfort break, after which Marian Dunlea will present. There will then be Q&A. The Q&A will open as soon as Olena Brante starts to speak. If you're on a laptop, the Q&A function will probably be along the bottom of your screen somewhere. But if you're on another device and you can't see it, please look for the three dots. Please type your questions in English or Ukrainian, and Catherine and Maxim Ilyashenko will be our moderators today, and they'll put as many questions as they can to Marianne and Olena. And the webinar will finish at 19:30 GMT. It's a little bit longer because we've got some demos. And so now it gives me great pleasure to introduce you to my colleague, Catherine Hines, who is an analyst in London, England. She works both in private practice, but also for the National Health Service, where she leads a large team of psychodynamic psychotherapists.
Thank you, Catherine, thank you.
I've still got a bit to go.
Sorry.
As some of you will be aware, you know, Catherine's deliberately stopping me at this point because I was going to say that Catherine helped me to set up WJ and was very involved in the day-to-day running of it. And at the moment, she is taking a step back from this because she's recently welcomed a Ukrainian colleague into her home and wishes to give that all the attention that it deserves. So well done, Catherine, and also everyone who's opened up their home. I think it's a really big thing to do. And thinking about that, it did prompt me earlier today to reflect on all our colleagues who are currently displaced, especially those who are with us here today or joining via the recording. You're so far from home, separated from family and friends, maybe from elderly parents or family members who are serving at the front. And I imagine that it must be quite lonely at times. Anxiety about the future, uncertainty over whether to stay or return, maybe guilt at the difficult choices that have had to be made, Svetlana Shevchenko mentioned that last time. I imagine you miss being in your own home, and you may even be anxious about whether your home's okay or not, or you may already know that it isn't. Missing your kitchen, your kettle, your bed, your language, your supermarket. But then I had an idea. As Jungians, we are very comfortable with the imaginal realm and its reality. So I'm going to take a risk here, and I'm going to invite you all, or everyone who's willing, to join me now in sending all our colleagues here who are far from home an imaginal hug, a warm, strong, yet gentle hug. And to those receiving it, as this webinar is concerned very much with the body, I invite you to take a moment and see if you can feel where it lands in you. So please join me in just sending a warm, strong, but gentle hug. And if you're far from home, just take a moment to receive it. And now I will hand over to Catherine Hines. Thank you, Catherine.
Thank you very much. Good evening, everyone. Dobry vecher. As Catherine Cox said, I'm Catherine Hines, a Jungian analyst in London, UK, and a member of the organising committee of With Ukrainian Jungians. And I'm honoured to be chairing the event this evening. A very warm welcome to everyone, especially our Ukrainian colleagues, wherever you are joining us from. In the first event run by WUJ in May last year, Anne Ulanoff spoke about the idea of erasure, that the war is an attempt to erase Ukraine and Ukrainians. We hope that these events will bring a little light into this darkness as we stand with you and support you in your struggle for peace and freedom. We also welcome those who've come to stand in solidarity. Over and over again, our Ukrainian colleagues have told us how much being together in community and finding ways to talk about what is happening does help. Thank you all for coming. As time goes on and we have now passed the first anniversary, support seems more important than ever. Through my personal contact over the last year with many members of the Ukrainian community, I've been awed by your courage and resilience in the face of war and loss, and your desire and enthusiasm to connect is very moving. We feel very enriched by the contact we have with you, as together we try to find ways to bear the unbearable. Since we last met, more suffering has been inflicted on Ukraine and further devastating lethal attacks on the country and those who live there. We heard this week of 17 children who'd been abducted and tortured and have now been freed and returned to their parents. The eastern Ukrainian city of Bakhmut, which has been devastated by fighting, appears to be stabilizing, with Ukrainian troops bravely holding back forces. The nightmare continues, both for those who remain in Ukraine and for refugees in other countries. Living and working in these conditions is a constant trial. In a moment, I would like to invite you to join together with us for a minute's silence as we remember all those who've been killed, injured, or tortured in the war in Ukraine. We remember also all those who've been abducted, tortured, sexually violated, those separated from family, and those who are grieving. We also remember all those around the globe who are affected by the conflict and who are struggling against domination and erasure. We now remember and join together for a minute's silence. And now we turn to tonight's webinar, which will look from different perspectives at the role of the body and how we can support and heal our bodies in difficult and challenging times. The body has its own innate wisdom, which, when we can listen to this, also helps to heal the psyche. Both our speakers tonight have deep personal experience of listening to their own bodies and using the transformational power of the body. I've known Marian Dunlea for many years and have been fortunate enough to participate in a few workshops with her. And if you get the opportunity to do this, I would highly recommend it. Marian Dunlea is a Jungian analyst and somatic experiencing practitioner who has been leading workshops internationally for 30 years. She is the head of Body Soul Europe Training Programme, the sister organisation for the Marian Woodman Foundation. And Marian has developed her own unique approach to working with the body and soul called BodyDreaming, which is an embodied Jungian approach drawing on neuroscience, trauma therapy, attachment theory, and Jung. Her book on her approach, BodyDreaming in the Treatment of Developmental Trauma, has won a number of awards. But first, Olena Brante is a Jungian analyst who grew up in Ukraine, but for the last 6 years has been living and working in Ireland, working both online in English and Ukrainian. Olena told me that she has often gravitated towards those who are foreign, and so in some ways it did not surprise her that she found herself living outside of Ukraine. Olena also told me about how important her own training in Jungian analysis in Ukraine was, and how this helped her to feel a sense of family and community. As you will hear, both Marian and Olena share a love of wild water swimming, and the effect that it has on body and soul. Olena, over to you.
Thank you, Catherine. I am very moved. It's so moving to be here today. Hello, dear colleagues. I'm so grateful to you for your being here today. I'm grateful to organizers and to interpreters. I'm grateful to Marian Dunlea. Thank you for having invited me to share this space today to speak about wholesome body practices. Now I will switch to my presentation. So, I would like to share with you today my interest in cold water swimming, or as it is also called, cold dipping or walrusing. Personally, I like the name zimne cold, because in Ukrainian, zimne kupanie, it means zimne, like cold and frosty. And at the same time, its origin came from the word zima, winter. I like the association with the season when part of the planet is covered with snow and ice to rest and recover for the next life cycle. In addition, cold swimming is a sport. But what I would like to talk about today is about dipping or simple swimming. I also practice cold water swimming. So what it is, cold water swimming? It is a stay in the sea, river, lake, in the cold season or in summer, but in water with a temperature below 15 degrees Celsius. The thermoneutral temperature of water for resting naked is approximately minus 35. So a person may experience a decrease in core body temperature when immersed in water at a lower temperature. The appropriate temperature for training for long distance swims is 25 Celsius. So the colder the water temperature, the shorter the time spent in it. In most cases, I will talk about water temperatures of 10 to 15 Celsius. Unfortunately, we won't be able to do any practical exercises, so I'm going to offer a short video to watch. Those who have experience of cold water swimming can recall it in detail, and those who are not familiar will get an image to join in.
Let's go back to our presentation from such a beautiful image. The unique healing effect of the cold water swimming and hypothermia from the point of view of science. Cold water swimming is evolving a practice which develops adaptive capacities, strengthens the immune system, and self-regulation of the central nervous system happens. And helping the depression, bipolar disorders, Alzheimer's disease, and even more. Cold water swimming has a healing effect on the human body. I was most interested in the nature of its effect on the psyche. And thanks to the rules of the cold water swimming, the process of hypothermia, when limited to a safe level, can be beneficial to a person. I'm going to focus on three main points caused by hypothermia. This is redistribution of blood circulation and renewal at the cellular level, cold shock proteins and cold shock hormones. And when the blood flows inside the body, and to the heart, brain, and internal organs, which increases the activity of mitochondria, activates metabolic and regenerative processes at the cellular level, as well as the dilation and narrowing of the blood vessels. At the water temperature of 10, 15 Celsius, after 3 minutes, the blood flows from the internal organs to the skin. And at this point, the person feels warm. Well, the scientists found all shock proteins in the human body, which are produced only when immersed in cold water or cryo-cooling. If you just exercise in the snow or douse yourself with water, the proteins are not produced. The appearance of cold shock protein triggers the process of restoring connections between the neurons. Well, the conservative protein CIRBP and RBM3, which are released in the mammal cells when temperature drops to 32, which is comfortable for reptiles. And during the cold water swimming, the hormones are being created, and they are called the hormones of the cold shock. And the process of emergence of these hormones is created by the cold temperature. So these hormones are produced additionally, androgens, corticosteroids, adrenaline, testosterone, and estrogen, and the serotonin. The appearance of cold shock hormones causes tension and then relaxation of the vagal nervous system and then the vagus nerves. You're probably familiar with this area of the vagus nerve and have heard of the tolerance window of the polyvagal theory of Stephen Porges. I am not going to talk about it for a long time, but I will tell you in brief that vagus nerve is responsible for the ability to relax and rest. In a state of constant stress or depression, it is constantly tensed, and a person cannot relax even during rest. Cold water swimming reboots the nervous system. So what are the rules of cold water swimming? The rules of cold water swimming are quite simple. Gradually enter the water because the body and the blood vessels must have time to adapt to temperature changes in order not to damage the connectivity of the body and mind. It is necessary to stay in the water for about 3 minutes at the water temperature about 12 degrees Celsius. When your body has warmed, well, it's time to get out of the water, and you need some protection: swimming suit, hat, slippers, gloves. The skin does not feel scratches from ice or pebbles during the cooling. Well, swimming in the wetsuit is not considered cold swimming. What is dangerous? It is dangerous immediately and sharply dive in with your head in. The skull is a bone. It does not warm up. So the blood vessels in the brain can change too quickly. The body must have time to synchronize the activity of sympathetic and parasympathetic nervous system. A sharp dive can lead to arrhythmics and lung collapse. It is dangerous to swim alone. It is dangerous to stay in the water for longer than 3 minutes or stay for a long time in the water after the body has warmed up. It is dangerous to stay with wet hands and wet bathing suits. Drinking alcohol to keep warm, among other things, this kills the effect of winter bathing. And pregnant women and children under 8 years of age are not recommended to swim. I would like to explain why 3 minutes. The myth is that there are several stages of cooling. There are three of them, and the third is death. Well, as you can see, well, this can be a short-term, long-term, and a collapse. Today, I am going to talk only about the superficial cooling of muscles and skin, which takes place within 3 minutes. Before going to look at the cold weather swimming for the perspective of myths and archetypes, I would like to brief you a little bit about the nature of trauma. The nature of trauma, we are talking here about PTSD, trauma of sexual abuse, early childhood development trauma, at the neurophysiological level, it is a traumatized connection and traumatized synchronization of the interaction of the three main parts of the brain: reptilian brain, limbic brain, and cortical brain. Well, reptilian brain develops in the womb. This is part of the brain which is responsible for the survival of a child or a person in times of danger or life-threatening situations. Fight, flight, freeze, flutter, reaction. Limbic brain develops after 8 months and is responsible for emotional maturity, behavior, control, and the ability to create healthy relations. And cortical brain is responsible for learning, language, reflection, morality, information processing, planning. It develops up to the age of 25. I would like also to draw your attention to the symbolism of death and dying that exists in trauma. Trauma is the experience of death, or rather the near-death experience, a movement of intense tension and mental exertion after which everything has changed: worldview, the person, the relation. And this is the experience of transformation. But after it, a person feels painfully separated, cut off, alienated, and not integrated into their own life, world, society, and relationship. It is a trap or a hiding place from a real transformation, change, development, and life. The experience of leaving the body when immersed in water during the cold water swimming, a strong feeling of fear of death is experienced. I also want to remind you once again about the following aspects of trauma. This is in trauma, time stands still. Suddenness, affect appears, and the gradualness and perception of cause and effect relationship is lost and distorted. And dissociation is the queen of defense in trauma. This is a paradox. What holds the world of trauma is of the nature of disconnection, of non-connection. I could have stopped here. I mean, the scientific analysis of this topic. But the danger is that fact now, how many minutes it takes for the body to warm up depends on many factors: age, weight, body fat, water temperature, air temperature, gusts of wind, and simply depends on individual factors. Therefore, cold water swimming is a practice of attention, meditation, mindfulness, where the focus of attention is now, when you know the physiology of the process, let us look at the psychology of the process. We can talk about the tracking. Well, the rule is not to dive into the water, but quite often newcomers to this kind of sports are trying to do it. But in the winter swimming, there is the framework which has been created by the nature itself. And this tracking is very important because it's an antidote to protect you from dissociation. For example, the body and sensation. What happens? The cold air, the freezing, the wind, the tension, pebbles, sand. The water is scaldingly cold, dense, pushing, hugging, salty. It is difficult to breathe, the chest tightens, the tension, the sky and the water, the absence of salt, the sky and the salt water, the force of waves, the movement, and as much movement as possible with the whole body. The surface of the skin is not felt, powerless, and yet unexpected relaxation of the chest and the whole body. Lightness, deep and full breathing is restored. Tingling sensation of the skin, the feeling of pleasure and warmth increases, salt on the skin, muscle joy, intense pleasure, the existence, strength, energy, and the sense of the world as a place of full beauty. Soul and feeling.
fear of impudent deaths, doubt, fear of the unknown, uncertainty, animal horror on the verge of madness, despair of the inevitable, panic, fuss, shame to give up, rage, anger, struggle, energy, existential loneliness, alienation, sadness, surprise, discoveries, a sense of pride and power, dissatisfaction with the end, playfulness, fun, laughter, and joy, harmony and tranquility, silence. And a couple of words about the status which happens to an individual when the individual emerges from the water. Harmony. Well, the world is beautiful and friendly in any weather, but the body of the human being is light and naturally beautiful. There is everything in the world to become whole, and there is nothing to add to it, and there is nothing to take from it. And it is an intense experience of the inner completeness of oneself, of one's presence in the world and the presence of the world in the oneself. The first immersion can create a very intense experience on the verge of sacredness and luminosity. Well, the myths through symbols actually reveal the nature of the trauma, of the feelings, the connection. So while reflecting on the wisdom of nature, I wondered where the cold water swimming came from, what archetypal energies create harmony, and why the walruses. And this is what I found. These countries, Latvia, Lithuania, Estonia, Sweden, Norway, Denmark, Finland, Russia, the UK, Ireland, Germany, Belgium, Switzerland, the Netherlands, China, Canada, America, Alaska, the Greenland, have a cold water swimming practice in their culture. The walruses, this is the name given to those who are practicing cold swimming in Ukraine. What are the walruses? What is the etymology of this word? Well, it came to the Sami language, Morse. Oh, it could have been taken to the European languages through the Finnish language. And in English, this word has been transformed into walrus. And also it exists in French. And in the Chukotka mythology, walrus is the spirit of the master of the sea. Walruses, others, seals, polar bears, are sacred spirits of water and that lived in two elements, land and sea, and contribute to the characters of a dog, a wolf, or a cat. In the culture of the northern peoples, the Inuits, there is a fairy tale about Sedna, the sea mother and the sea woman. I did not find this fairy tale in the Baltic states, Eastern Europe, and Russia, but the Northern America, Scandinavia, the UK, and Ireland know it well. In all countries, the body of the fairy tale does not change. Senda has no mother. The father is the haunting, murderous figure. The reality of relationship is full of emptiness. Senda's death always happens in the same way. After the death, Senda has become the lady of the underwater world. And this is the fairy tale. An old widower and his daughter Sidna, who was so beautiful that all the Eskimos wanted to marry her, once lived near the Arctic Ocean. But she refused all the offers. And one day, a seabird came to her in the form of a handsome man, and he promised her a gentle life in a warm wigwam full of bearskins and fish. Sidna flew away with him, but the bird lied, and Sidna found only the stinking nest on the island full of birds, where she ate only raw fish. And she regretted her rejection of handsome men, and he complained to her father when he visited her. Anguta, and it means a man, in translation, a man with something to cut off. He put the daughter in the kayak to bring her to the human world. He stole wife from the bird, so bird gave chase, caught up with him and attacked Sidna's father. And he started to struggle. And when Angutta realized that it was hopeless, he pushed Sinda overboard to drown. For a moment, she managed to grab the edge of the canoe with the frozen fingers, but the old man was so frightened that he hit her hands with a paddle and cut off her fingers. And Sinda tried to grab hold on the boat again, but her father cut off her arms at the elbow. And when she came for air for the third time, and he still cut off her arms and elbows, when she made up for the air for the third time, he just cut her hands, and she drowned. "I have to do it," father shouted, overcome with fear. "Bird, your husband is angry with the sea and demands the life." Yosidna's body slowly disappeared under the icy water. Her fingers turned into fish, her middle joints into seals and walruses, and her shoulders into whales. The father returned home to his hut and fell asleep sobbing. At night, a violent storm came and carried the sleeping father into the depths of the sea. There is another version according to which the father took Sedna into the boat, but he cursed himself, the daughter, the world, and they both disappeared in the sea. Since then, Sinda has become the lady of the death and life, or the old food, well, who feeds the people, rules the sea and all marine animals, and controls the water at the sea. Well, Sinda is ready to provide food to the people if they accept their rules. But if the rules are violated, Sidna's hands hurt, and she punishes people with diseases, hunger, and storms. To alleviate Sidna's suffering, the shaman goes to the land of death and combs Sidna's hair. Transformation of a woman into goddess is a widespread narrative which indicates interaction with the archetypal energies. Psyche and Ariadna was transformed in the same way, although Sedna belongs to an earlier generation of female goddesses. Her image is less differentiated, and features of various goddesses and fairy tale characters can be found in her. Kali, Ishtar, Hecate, Aphrodite, Baba Yaga, the handless girl Psyche. Reflecting on the emotional state after the bathing and the neurological effect of the cold shock, well, I thought about the Aphrodite, the daughter of Aphrodite, Harmony. And Aphrodite was born from this sea without a mother. It was born as a result of a cutoff, restoring her virginity by swimming in the sea, the eternally young and beautiful goddess of life. Sidna lacks the balance between the feminine and the masculine. Sidna gives birth to children through cutoff, unlike Aphrodite. And as Sidna's case, the transformation from daughter, wife to mother is instantaneous, and the space measured by time is excluded. I think it will be interesting to look at who Hecate is and what is her sense of time. Hecate is the guide through the period of transformation. Her name is Krona. She knows various feminine roles, and he helps to make a transition from one to another, consolidate their existence. And their attributes are the sword and torch, like Psyche, the lunar goddess of the dark places of the human soul, the goddess of transformation and crossroads. She helps to cut off what has become unnecessary, helps to go through a difficult period to find meaning and the right time. She helps not to act, but to be in the moment. She knows the sequence. She is able to see the trauma and endure it, because it is aware of different nature of time. Let's call it feminine. And the lack of attention to such feminine understanding of time, the state of preparedness to measure the internal psychic space in the complex of negative or dead mother. It's the space which is full of persecution and lack of harmony. And this creates the field for dissociation. Harmony always is being born from differences because of the opposites, because the harmony is a combination of many similar entities and very divergent ones. And all the characters and circumstances help to appear harmony as the child offered it, well, the time for maturity needs. And it is necessary to create a container, which is created by Hecata, and also Aris is needed, who really knows, protects his children, who is maybe the only one in Olymp who does not acknowledge the violence in the love. He understands everything about the borders and taboos. And this helps to transform the unconscious experience. It activates the practicing of focusing the attention and helps to concentrate in the processes of internal and external reality.
When the rules and taboos are brought in, the function of thinking starts working differently. It starts comprehending what's happening inside the person. While if we speak about the myth of Aphrodite and Ares and about their children, we could consider the tracking from a different perspective. Let me remind you the story. This is Phobos, fear, Deimos, panic and fear of death, Anteras, hatred and rage, Potosis, existential loneliness, longing, sweet pain and languor, Chimeras, bodily arousal, Eros, pleasure, connection, vitality, and harmony, which is about fullness of being and embodiment. These are children of Ares and Aphrodite. And if we consider the various phases, here you see the Ukrainian text, and the next slide you will see the English. So if we try and compare the children of Ares and Aphrodite, we receive actually the pattern of cold swimming tracking when the soul and body undergo various phases. And this is the English version of the slide. In this way, the body becomes the alchemic vessel. The body is a retort where the feelings are stages. And the cold water, this is the third element that contributes into the transformation. And maybe it makes sense to go back to the slide and have another look at that. Phobos, Deimos, Anteras, Potosis, Chimeras, Eros, and Harmony. Fear, panic, fear of death, aggression, aggressiveness, feeling lonely, separated, existential loneliness, then bodily arousal, pleasure, and harmony. The significance of extreme fear of death in the process of cold water swimming. Cold water swimming creates an environment for the emergence of the image of death as a connecting symbol between body and soul. This is quite a brief emotional experience of dying, of fear, and the external experience of contact with danger that coincide for a brief moment with the internal experience of trauma. Cold bathing creates the process of regeneration, which takes place literally with the help of proteins and hormones of cold shock, and it becomes a literal experience of symbolic dying on the bodily level. And again, it is important that this coincides with the emotion of fear of death. In this way, the connection with the dissociated material is reconstructed, and bit by bit, the possibility of living through this experience happens. Conclusions. In cold swimming, the body turns into an alchemic vessel in which neural connections and the same system of mental self-regulation are restored. Then it facilitates depressive symptoms of depression. The level of anxiety and tension are relieved, and people get adaptation to feelings. They restore control in stressful situation. Progression and causality are restored. The resource for replenishing the deficit is rediscovered within the person, and this eliminates the dependent and codependent possession. Instead, it awakens the experience of potentiality. It is about discovery of one's own strengths of spirit. The inner space of time and place for feelings is created as a place of being of the soul. The observing ego develops and makes the process of embodiment of the self conscious and complete, and the birth and embodiment of lost parts of the soul take place. And that's it on my side.
Wow, Olena, thank you very much indeed for that. I never thought I'd see the day where I would consider sticking my toe into cold water. Apologies there for a little few sound problems with the English translation. We did do sound checks before, but we seem to have had a little bit of an issue there. So we're now going to take a 5-minute comfort break, and then we're going to hand over to Marian Dunlea. See you in 5 minutes. Thank you. Hello, everyone, and welcome back. It gives me great pleasure now to hand over to Marian Dunlea. Thank you, Marian.
Thank you, Catherine, and it gives me great pleasure to be here and to have this moment to share with you my experience of working body dreaming, something that has emerged pre-pandemic. My book was published, and really, it's been an extraordinary experience working with the Ukrainian group for the past year in supervision. And I feel very blessed by that experience, the privilege of working with people firsthand who are living both in exile from the experience or living day to day there, and having the gift and the honor of being able to bring the work into the situation and to develop together what is important in building resilience and ease and flow into our systems when we're very often bombarded, overwhelmed, and living many of those moments on the edge of death that Olena spoke about. And just to say, Olena, I really enjoyed your presentation and all the information you shared with us. So we had some great times in preparing our day today. So I would like to begin saying a little bit about my background with working with Marian Woodman, a Jungian analyst who whose work is very much based in the body, and brought us all into, I would say, quite a similar experience to the cold water immersion. Letting go of land and taking us out into out onto the sea of the somatic field to discover really new countries. That's a quote you used to love to say from Gide: if you would find new countries, you must be prepared to lose sight of land for a long time. And that is really, when we think about, as Jungians, we think about the sea and the unconscious. For Marian, it was very much working with psyche and soma together in that field of the sea and finding new territories. And that was an amazing experience for me and life changing. And from there, I moved into working with trauma work, particularly Peter Levine's work, which he's the founder of Somatic Experiencing. And that work really introduced me to very much the workings of the body-psyche connection. In particular, the focus is on the nervous system. And that gave me really, I was very passionate. It was like an awakening for me to suddenly have a light go on to many of the practices we had done in the body-soul work with Marian Woodman, but to take it into a whole other sense of understanding with neuroscience and with the experience of Peter's work in trauma and the connection with body and psyche and the nervous system. So I decided that I was teaching workshops for many, many years, about 30 years, and I decided to I needed to write about this wonderful work of Jung and Marian Woodman's adaptation of Jung into the body and then the trauma field, bringing all of that together. Was an experience. So I took myself to Küsnacht and was writing there. And I would say, until I came upon the metaphor that really is the central metaphor of the book, which is the metaphor of Newgrange, a megalithic site in Ireland, I wasn't able to really bring it together. But once I had that metaphor, it was like the key. And Marian always encouraged us to work with metaphor as a means of, it's like a bridge between the body, the mind, the emotions, and the psyche, and imagination, of course. So it's the transformation, it's transforming something. And I can see that that image of Newgrange was very powerful. And for me, the experience of Newgrange was really about alignment, where I situate myself. And I think that's the holding metaphor, really, in this work, that we situate ourselves as Jungians with the belief that the self is regulating. It's a guiding principle. It's moving us towards wholeness. And in Newgrange, in this megalithic site, the whole orientation is towards the winter sunrise, which the passageway of this architectural tomb or womb shape, as it has in its internal structure, is facing the rising sun. And the rising sun of the solstice, as we know, is cyclical. It comes every winter solstice without fail. And the sun, if there are no clouds there, the sunlight will penetrate into the recesses, the long passageway, it's about 70 feet long, right into the center of this womb-like space. And there illuminates the space and the art and the triple spiral, which is at the back. So I'm going to show you the slides of this just to get you a sense of how the metaphor for alignment is so powerful. And then I'll explain why I think alignment and that concept of self-regulation really is like a tuning fork for us in the work. Whether we're working with trauma, whether we're working with dreams, it's where we place ourselves, what we are standing in alignment with. So I'm going to share a screen with you. Okay. Everybody's seeing okay, I hope. You let me know if there's an issue. Thanks. So this is, is that full screen there? I don't know whether I'm on full screen or not. We'll just work with that for now. So that's the entrance passageway behind the stone. You can see, and that's the threshold stone. And I love the megalithic art on the threshold stone, all the spirals, the double and the triple spiral are there. And then you can see the box above the passageway, the light box, where the light enters the passageway at equinox. Here it is coming through. You can see climbing steadily. It takes about 15, 18 minutes to come up the passageway into the center of this space. And here it is arriving, and we have the triple spiral. It's quite a moment to really to take in again, feel the resonance in your body with that image. At the millennium, I think it was, they had a video of it, I think they showed it. I think it wasn't the millennium, it was when we went into 2020, the new year morning, they showed the sunrise coming up the passageway, and I thought it was amazing that it was broadcast live around the world. So this, I want to just bring us back to Jung. The separation of psychology from the basic assumption of biology is purely artificial because the human psyche lives in indissoluble union with the body. And for me, that's really the holding metaphor of Newgrange, that sunlight, the rising sun, the cyclical sunrise of the solstice coming into that shape of body, of matter, of earth. So you have sky and earth meeting, you have body and psyche meeting, the principle of earth and sky. And it's an alchemical force, as it were, that's in our world and it's in nature. It comes back every spring with the days begin to lengthen. And what it meant in times of darkness, that we could count on that. And so I'm always feeling into and listening into that there is something here that is self-regulating and we need to attune to that. That's the alignment force that I'm mentioning all the time. Since the psyche is self-regulatory, just as the body is, the regulating counteraction will always develop in the unconscious. And I would add, the somatic unconscious there. Jung is saying the psyche finds its counterpoint, its counteraction in the unconscious to regulate, like we say, dreams help to regulate a current situation. So there's a kind of a misbalance, something is out of balance, out of kilter, and then this, we'll have the dream that will help us. Well, in what we know from working with the body, that the counteraction will occur in the somatic unconscious, which is really powerful. And we'll see that as we go along. At the time when trauma occurs, there's a healing vortex created. This is Levine's principle now. And I like it in virtue of seeing these spirals behind us, because he said that when a trauma happens, our energy is caught in a vortex and we have a particular response in our nervous system, which causes us either to fight, flight, or freeze. And with that happening, instantaneous with it, there's a counter vortex set up in our system, which is a healing vortex. So right away, there is a polarity, night and day, dark and light, sun and earth. Here we have a trauma and we have healing. And that dyad, if you like, and that working together is really so crucial to our work, to know that we have, wherever we are going to put our attention, we can find the counterpoint available to us, either checking in with the body and working so that somatic information can come to us from its depths, or indeed through dream work. But in working with the depths that's held in the body and the wisdom in the body, we renegotiate trauma. He says we oscillate between the two positions. And this is also key to the work, that there's a movement. We're not stuck in one position, but that we build into the system, into our physiology, into our biology, our capacity to move between the two. Trauma can really isolate us in one, but if you're working somatically, you're inviting that healing vortex into the conversation. And somehow or other, between the two, a new third begins to emerge. And as we know, that's Jung's concept of the transcendent function. Now, this word coherence is really important in terms of neuroscience and what they are feeling about and coming to discover, that everything in the universe has a sense of coherence about it in its form, as a capacity, let's say anyway, for coherence. And coherence is an engine for resilience. And resilience is a word that people really like to use. And people think of resilience and what the strength and the resilience of people in terms of survival. But we need to feed the resilience in a way by bringing in the coherence factor, by sensation. Through sensation, we have a sense of what coherence feels like for us. What does it feel like to be resilient and to bring in that stance of realizing that it is a physiological state that is pleasurable, actually. There is pleasure in it, and all nature has that capacity. And it's very, very important because we recognize it. Our own organism recognizes coherence, and we ping off each other's coherence. We're actually attracted to coherence. And that's very important as therapists to know that we have the capacity to bring ourselves into a more coherent state, and our clients will feel that. I'm thinking of one of the groups that I'm working with, was speaking to a client who was so distraught that there was no way they could speak to something that was happening. They just could not address it. And this was very difficult for the therapist. What do you do when you know there's a massive element of grief in the room, a huge elephant? What are we going to do? And so when we were working, this was coming up for her, and I was leading an exercise that we're going to do later called orienting, where we orient, where we align. And in this exercise, she could feel that my voice and the invitation to do the exercise had really, she was pinging off the coherence in the work. She was feeling calmer, and that she was taking something in. As we say in the mother-infant situation, the prosody of my voice, the attunement with that, the tone of my voice, the rhythm of my voice, enabled her to just receive what was happening and follow the exercise. And when we were working with the frustration and the supervision then, looking at the client and the client who's holding something so big that it cannot be spoken. And there's terror that she'll fall completely apart if she names this, what she's living with, something that had happened for her in the war. And that is a current, an ongoing situation. And what was really interesting was the therapist was able to recall a moment where she was able to feel this sense of ease and able to go with the exercise. There was something that in my voice that allowed her to just be at ease for a moment to follow it. And she used the word, it's like you were like a tuning fork, and I was able to go with that. And what happened as she began to recognize that in her own system, she was able to say, maybe I can be the tuning fork for this client. And it was very, very moving just to hold that moment, that our ease and the resilience and the coherence that we can bring into our own system for just a moment can have such an effect on another. This is a word that's often used. Again, it's got the sense of movement. We pendulate between states of activation and deactivation. And that's like when we're in trauma, we often can feel our system is caught in a sympathetic and fight flight. We're constantly in go motion. Whereas we need to be, for survival, able to be vigilant and discriminating with our sound. What's that? Where am I going? What does that mean? Should I be moving now towards a shelter? Should I not? All of this sense of being on alert. At the same time, when we're taking those moments for our cup of coffee or a break or a chat with somebody, that we become conscious enough to bring in a restoration, to bring in a rhythm of dropping down. It's like there's the upward movement and then there's the downward movement. I like to see it as a wave. And when we get into the pendulation and we allow ourselves move through, we need to become conscious when the wave is dropping on the shore. And when we're more conscious of these moments, then we're more conscious of a pendulation in our system. It's not going to get caught to the same degree. In hypervigilance, there's going to be moments of reprieve and restoration, which is an expansion then. When we have greater movement in our system, we have greater capacity. When we have greater capacity, we can be more present internally and to those around us. I thought this was important in terms, again, of the spirals, but also in terms of just this tension that's being held at the moment. That reminder from Jung from 1942, the greater the tension, the greater the potential. Great energy springs from correspondingly great tension of opposites. But it's the working the two, it's not polarizing. And here we are back to threshold, or threshold stone. In body dreaming, we're working to restore regulation and coherence in our system. So we're repatterning our nervous system and we're creating new neural pathways. Now they sound like big claims, but in fact, they're very palpable as experiences in our body and in our psyche, the two working together, the body-mind. We can learn how to reset our nervous system and we realign, and here's the alignment word, with inherent organic capacity. So we're not inventing something, we're aligning with what is already in our organisms, the capacity for self-regulation. The work necessitates a safe place. If we don't have a safe place and we practice all these things, then we're maintaining defenses. We're not changing things. It's the same, the the client will walk out with the same nervous system. But our work in body dreaming is to reset the nervous system. How do we do that? Because you need safety. How are we going to create a safe place when there's a war, when there's so much going on for people? How to create a safe place. So I thought best look at the nervous system for that, because you can see the rise of the wave that I describe here. This is the sympathetic system, and this is the wave coming down in the parasympathetic. And then it goes up again, and then it comes down. And it goes up naturally with our breath and comes down with the exhale. And sometimes it doesn't come down with the exhale. Sometimes we're caught and with something happening, like it can be just hearing the news, or I get a phone call, or something has happened and I hear a bomb has gone off and my family are in that area. Well, I'm going to go immediately into outside what we call this yellow line that's broken here. The window of tolerance is what Dan Siegel would call it, or Pat Ogden. I can be absolutely catapulted outside into massive anxiety. But what is going to bring me back down? I've just heard, had a phone call that everything's okay and they're fine. But how do I tell my system it's fine for now, they're okay? How do I bring it down again? And there, hopefully, I'll be showing you and demonstrating some of the things that can support us to reestablish the flow after an event, because the nervous system doesn't get it's happened, they're safe right now, it's okay. Let the wave come back down. Sometimes working with breath, with the exhale, is very, very helpful. That creates a release. So extending the exhale and doing it with somebody, just very, very gently, never having to do something big. You always do, it's just the just noticeable difference is the phrase I love to use. It came from Fechner, who preceded Freud. And I think it's so handy. And again, with the breath, some people think, oh, we've got to do a big long breath here now. No, just really, you know, what's the normal breath? What are you holding right now? And just see what it's like if we just hold that a little bit. And people begin to recognize that actually they've been holding their breath and they've been shortening the exhale for months. Some people will have done it before the war. Some people may be doing it since 2014. Many of us in our lives have had traumas and we're still in our systems not aware that we've come through that. So this is more about the sympathetic system. You can have a read of that. It's about our action. It's about getting ready for going and doing. It's urgency, and the heart rate increases and the blood pressure is ready. And so this is all, and in terms of enjoyment and getting ready for good things in life, it's also the sympathetic system. It's not just about trauma, but it's, we can end up in times of fight, which might be the anger, or flight, which might be related to fear, as a predominant defenses against a sympathetic, if you like it. They're sympathetic defenses against what is perceived as danger. Here we have rest and digest. These are the rest and digest. This is the parasympathetic. This is the wave coming right down. And it allows for deeper, slower breaths. That's key. A lot of the parasympathetic is, again, it's in our nature. We're not inventing it. We're not creating it. It knows how to do it, but we have to go back towards it to and give ourselves the capacity for it. When it's there as a defense, it may go into complete immobilization, because that was the best way to survive in a situation, was to freeze. And so that's very helpful. But it may not be helpful if it continues and we remain stuck in that. Normal conditions, we have a temporary increase in stress hormones, or our heart rates increases when there is a stress factor out. And as soon as the threat is over, the hormones dissipate and the body returns to normal. But for stress hormones in traumatized peoples, it takes much, much longer to return to bring it down. And as I said, many of us can stuck and never get back out of it. In fact, that's one of the things with clients as I'm reading from the beginning, from when they come in the door, in a way, is what are they maintaining as the defense in the autonomic nervous system? Are they coming from fight, flight, or freeze that have become habitual? Now, a bit like Olena put up the polyvagal here. This is the vagus nerve, and I just want to show you how important it is because it links every organ in the body. Every organ in the body, you can see from the head, neck, and shoulders down into the lung and heart area, and there through the stomach, and the liver, and the spleen, and right down into our fertility organs. The vagus nerve, that's from Stephen Porges' work. So right down in the depths of our belly, the dorsal vagal parasympathetic branch comes in, and this causes the immobilization, collapse, or freeze. And in terms of phylogenetically, this came on first. You know, it's like the possum who plays dead. So we have that capacity. When all else fails, we get into the dorsal freeze. And again, it's life saving. However, it may be not very healthy for us and cause a lot of problems physiologically and mentally. Then the sympathetic is that midline, it's around the heart and the lungs, and this is where we get ready for action, fight or flight. Again, healthy to defend against a situation, but maintaining it constantly is the issue, is the difficult piece. And the third is the social engagement. It's the ventral system that we control with all these actions up here, the eyes, the ears, the mouth, our voice, our neck, how we can move it, our head and neck. So very, very important is the social engagement, because not alone does it alert us when something is happening, so it gets the message straight across, get ready for something, get ready for action, this isn't safe, we hear a sound. It is wired directly to the heart and lungs. So it gets us into action, but equally so, we can say, oh no, that sound is all right, we don't have to move, and it can calm the heart. It's the one the mother is using constantly when she's soothing a child. And I say the mother, the primary caregiver with the infant. The social engagement system, it dampens activation, thank you. And it really helps that hypothalamus, pituitary, adrenal axis. That's the axis where the hormones are pumped out. And if you had a flooding of these hormones, all the ones that you were naming there, Elena, earlier, if they're pumping because there's an activation, there's an anticipation, there's a sense of vigilance, then it's putting huge pressure on the adrenal system in the body. But the social engagement can calm us down. Somehow in the exercise that I did the other day, the therapist in the supervision group was able to, in a way, go with the exercise, feel that she could go with it. And in going with it, she could feel just a little bit of calm coming in. Whereas she began the session in a state of hypervigilance because something had happened and her system hadn't been able to take in that it was now over and that everybody was safe. She was still in the terror that had happened and gripped her. Here we have, just want to show you the eyes, the ears, the jaw, the head and neck. This is how we stimulate the ventral vagus with our voice as well. It soothes and calms the heart and lungs. Really important. This is what was so difficult during COVID times when people were wearing masks because we weren't able to use the social engagement in the same way. And people became more and more and more isolated. And we know that people's immune systems were really hit by that. We don't even know the cost of that still. And here we're back to the dissociation that happens with the dorsal vagus. And I wanted to put this in because I really think it's important when the dissociation is there and the freeze is there, it cuts us off both externally and internally. We don't know who we are. We are lost to ourselves. I had a very powerful experience of that with somebody in supervision recently, again, the same sense that the distress was major. And this person was not living in the war situation. She is one of the refugees, but that sense of loss of self and disturbance and completely caught in a whirl, a maelstrom really of activation. And we worked and worked in terms of I was listening and I was working with the feelings that were coming in, and it just wasn't settling anywhere. And yet just tracking and following all the way what's happening here and what's happening there. And then all of a sudden, what happened was an image came. She connected to a dream image. And that dream image was the gift. Straight from the psyche, the gift comes of the dream image. And at that point, we could look at the shape of the dream image, what it looked like, what she was connected with in it, and then how did it make her feel? And at that point is the moment where you're impregnating. It's like the sun coming through into the heart of that megalithic tomb. You say, where in the body are you connecting with that dream? What happens? I feel good. That's what she said. I feel good. So I said, how do you know you feel good? Well, my body is moving more easily. I feel at ease, but my body is moving. And then she said, and I love to move. I actually have to move. And it's like something was restored in that moment. That sense of self would come back in. Now, that session had been really like this, talk about a swing from the trauma vortex and the image restoring us into the counterpoint there of the healing vortex. But it landing in the body, the recognition that I feel good. This is where you get the recognition of the coherence that's coming in. And with the recognition, realizing it's in my body, my movement is freer. I'm able to move and there's ease in my movement. Really important. Yeah, I'm just greater ease, flow, a sense of coherence and wholeness comes in when we're deactivating. Lovely. So what do we use to deactivate? How do we regulate, we could say, what are resources? Then they're like internal or external anchors that help us. So Levine, in his trauma work, somatic experiencing, way back when he started working on it about 30 years ago, he was inviting people to think about, to imagine. We talked about imagining. Elena was speaking about imagining. Imagine a day you were happy. Imagine a visit to the sea. Have you got a dog? Imagine being with your favorite animal. Imagine a stuffed toy. If it's a kid, what's it like? Who is your stuffed toy? What's your favorite thing? So you're bringing in things, the imagination, to bring in the calm into the system. That's what an anchor is. It could be a person that you love and care for, a place. And it helps maintain a sense of self. Sometimes it might even be, when did you last really feel good? What made you feel good? It's getting that sense of self restores the integrity when there's a lot of disruption. So these are resources that Levine would use actively to create the counter vortex to the trauma. And then he would move between the two. And then orienting is something that I came across in the somatic experiencing world. Steve Hoskinson brought this in. And it's using the architecture of the social engagement system, which we know has immediate impact on the heart and lungs. And this exercise is the one I'd like to do with you in a little while. And I'll just use this, I'll read this out to you. Let your eyes go for a walk in the space around you. It may be around you in the room that you're looking, or you may be looking out through the window. Let them go where they want to go. So that's key. You're not taking your eyes for a walk. It's not egoic. It's from, in a way, the unconscious. What is drawing their attention? You stopped there. go back, what, look at that again. What was it you looked at? You hardly noticed it, but your head kind of just lingered there for a sec. Go back, look at it, and be curious about it. And then say to yourself quite simply, what am I looking at? Just describe in detail the physicality of what it is you're looking at. So what are we doing there? We're orienting away from activation. So the system is activated. We're bringing in the social engagement to bring calm into the system. And then when we have that established and we're looking at something, we're describing it to ourselves, I'll then bring in a question that will bring in the felt sense. The felt sense is Eugene Gendelin's work, and it's about body resonance. How is my body responding to the conversation I'm having right now, describing this object that I'm looking at and my eyes were fascinated by? What happens to my body? What am I noticing? And then I ask the question, is there a difference? And here's the key again to the just noticeable difference. Because as I notice a difference, it's like that's the beginning of laying down the new neural pathway. It's like the synapses have fired, but in bringing attention to it, I then bring energy to that, and that's where the firing of the pathway happens. What I'm looking at, we could say it's a chosen object. We say it's kind of like a found object. It finds us. I didn't go and look for it. It found us. And it's often really interesting in terms of a Jungian thing, how it's like having a dream image. It offers a counterpoint to the presenting symptom or issue. Now, that's not something I want to hold as, what would I say? I don't want to make that heavy work in a session, but I'm taking it in as I'm listening to it, that there's a reason that this particular thing has been chosen right now, not alone for just bringing in the issue of reducing the heart rate from an activated state. What I love about this is it really ties in with active imagination. And a particular word that Jung liked to use was betrachten, which means a German word. It's old German and it means to look. But it looks, when we look with a certain eye at something, we're actually impregnating it. We fill it with living power and it becomes pregnant. It has the power to work on us. It's like there's, it becomes a conversation. There's an active engagement between us, a reciprocity, you could say. So in the end, the chosen object ends up either down-regulating us when we're very hyper, it brings that wave down, or indeed if we're down in the freeze, under the wave, as it were, it can lift us up. And in doing that, down-regulating or up-regulating, it helps to maintain greater openness and receptivity to feelings, images, memory, dreams. So I'm going to break it there. And we're going to just do this exercise with each other for a while. So I'm going to lead you, if you like, into, I'm going to lead you into an exercise. So firstly, I'll just invite you maybe to move a little bit because you've been listening to my voice now and you might be getting a bit tired. You might want a little stretch. Make yourself, as they say, comfortable, whatever that is for you. It's different for other people. Some people might like to lie down at this point. Somebody might like to stand up at this point. And I will lead an exercise so you can make yourself comfortable. And as you're doing so, just noticing what contact you have. If you're on the ground, just feeling any contact you have on the ground, like your feet may be on the ground. Or you may have laid down and your whole body is against the ground. Or you might be in a chair. Notice the contact with the chair. Points of contact with your body is often really helpful as a place of just meeting yourself physically. Yeah, they're my thighs, that's my bum, and these are my feet, my hands, how my arms are settled. I might even notice my breath. I might, you don't have to, but you might notice your breath, and maybe you might notice the space that your breath is occupying. Like, do you notice your breath in your throat or your nose or your chest? Some people might notice breath in the belly. Where do you feel breath? You might notice it in your back. Wherever you're noticing breath, see if you can notice there's a sort of spaciousness there. You may notice a rhythm even in that spaciousness. What it's like for you to just notice it, not having to change it, just noticing your rhythm of breath right now. And perhaps noticing how your whole body responds to this rhythm of breath. So it may be your chest you are noticing, and then you just say, how's my whole body responding now? And just giving yourself a moment with that. And when you're ready, with soft eyes, not hard eyes, you're not finding, looking, searching, you're just allowing your eyes to take you for a walk. It may be the space immediately around you, or it may be outside if there's a window open and there's light. But just see where your eyes want to go. They might want to go, and it's a good idea to move the chin towards one shoulder and another shoulder. That's the whole architecture, we say, of the social engagement. And you may notice that there was a kind of a hesitation somewhere, or there was something that you saw that you mightn't have seen before. Oh, what is that? I'm curious about that. And again, when we look at it, we're just describing it to ourselves. Okay, as if we're looking at it for the first time. What's the shape of it? What's the size of it? The texture, maybe. Maybe its position in relation to something around it. And then just notice from that little engagement with it, how you're feeling in yourself. So at this point, I'm going to bring you back to the screen, away from your object. You can go and look at it anytime you want and continue the conversation or see how the engagement continues. But right now I'm going to invite a couple of people. We're going to do one person first. Neil, have you got somebody for us there to do a demo with?
I do. I present you Olena.
Thank you. Hi, Olena. Can you unmute yourself? Great.
Good evening. I'm so happy to see and hear you all.
I felt, well, let me first describe the object that I was looking at. You can hear me, right?
Very clearly, yeah, Olena. That would be great just to tell us, just before you go to the object, I'm just going to just see, where are you from? You want to tell us where you're from?
I'm in Ukraine now.
You're in Ukraine.
In the city of Odessa.
Odessa. Thank you. Thank you, Olena, for that. Okay. And so when you looked around the room, how was that for you?
That was very interesting to observe my feelings, sensations, and thoughts that came to me, because I'm here in my room, which mm-hmm. I've seen many times. I've kind of experienced that many times. Mm-hmm. And when I slowly walked around my room, yeah. I was surprised because I discovered an interesting thing in my room, and that's the door. The door that is wooden and there is glass mm-hmm. in it. It looks quite classic. And I felt, well, first I was so surprised that I discovered the door. It was quite a nice feeling, quite an ordinary door. I see the door many times during the day, but somehow it felt so fresh. I felt hope and ease. I mm-hmm. somehow wanted to open the door and step out of the door.
Mm-hmm. Lovely. So I'm going to slow you down a little bit there. That's lovely that you found that ease and hope with it, and the desire to open it and to go out of it. So I'm wondering how your body is in that conversation. Is there anything in your body that you're noticing while you're talking to us about that?
That's strange, but I'm so calm, balanced.
Just now, or generally?
Just now, right. Just now. I am so yeah. calm.
Yeah.
After I managed to come in touch with that.
Yeah, you managed. And where would you notice the calm, Olena?
I notice it in my chest, I guess.
Yeah.
This is the chest where I'm breathing and where I experience my breathing as well. Very yeah. often I notice that I breathe slowly or too fast there, and yeah. thus I may feel tension or relaxation in my chest.
And with the exercise, you feel greater ease coming into that.
Yes, right.
Yeah, lovely. Okay, so Olena, I'm really grateful for you coming in to do the demo with us, because I just wanted to hear a voice, and I will hear somebody else as well now, just to see what that engagement can feel like. And that simple exercise, you know, I mightn't do it with an introduction like we did, or in terms of the spaciousness, because I was bringing that in a way just to land everybody for the work. But it's the exercise itself that can be so helpful when there's a lot of activation. But it's reminding us what we have the tools already to do, and we can do. So thank you, Olena, for that. Bye-bye. Ciao.
And thank you.
Thank you. And who's next, Neil, there?
I present you Raymond.
Thank you. Super. Hi, Raymond.
Hi there. Hi.
And Raymond, where are you living?
Yeah, I'm based up in Sheffield. That's in the north of England.
Great. Well, we're delighted. We're going from Odessa to the north of England. That's a nice span. Good. And how are you doing today?
Yeah. Well, I mean, I definitely feel a bit more relaxed after doing that. So yeah, I'm good.
How are you before it?
Well, I mean, not particularly anxious, but just, you know, just Felt okay, but I think I just feel a bit more relaxed after doing the exercise. Yeah.
Yeah. What did your eyes fall on?
Well, first I thought I kind of look outside.
Yeah.
And then I just noticed, I always just kind of felt really, I felt the peacefulness. So, you know, basically, you know, it's, I just, the window looks onto a street. So yeah. I just felt it was very peaceful. Yeah. Yeah. And then looking around my, well, bedroom, I looked around and I noticed like the duvet, I felt the softness. Mm-hmm. I felt the softness of the duvet. Mm-hmm. And then the glass, and then I felt the hardness of the glass.
So you were kind of experimenting in some way with the touch there, the softness and the hardness.
Yeah, surprisingly, for example, I wouldn't, you know, normally when I look at things, I don't think of things in terms of texture.
Yeah. But
for some reason, doing this exercise, that came up, that kind of, I thought in terms of the texture. Yeah.
The texture. And that's quite a new thing for you.
Yeah.
And how does it feel like that, to have, you know, opened a new door, as it were, into curiosity for texture?
I don't know what it means, but in a sense, just, you know, I've just, you know, it's like, I just thought it was a nice, you know, a nice touch, really, just, you know, just to see things in different ways, really, you know. I just thought that was nice.
Great. I love that. It's a nice touch. Apropos. Yeah, very good. And I also see a big smile on your face when you're saying it, like it was pleasurable.
Yeah. Because I think it kind of maybe brings a kind of more sense of a connection. Because I think after doing the exercise, I feel more connected. So I felt that kind of maybe thinking of things in terms of the material. It's more of a kind of, I feel more centered or more connected. Yeah.
Lovely. Yeah. And that word is very important to us when we're activated, whatever circumstances, to have a sense of connection with ourselves is lovely. Really nice. That's very nice, Raymond. I really appreciate you sharing that.
Okay, that's fine. No problem.
Thank you.
Okay, thank you.
Great. Super. So, and I think we have one more person there, Neil.
Yes, I present you, Helen.
Thank you. Helen, how are you? You're on mute now, I think. You'll have to unmute. There you are. Great. And you are where, Helen? Ontario, Canada, where Marian Woodman lived. There you go, my mentor and teacher. So where did you look, Helen? Did you say a yoga poster? A bolster. Yeah, I get it. Okay. And what was it about the bolster? What did you see when you looked at it today? Yeah. Mm-hmm. Mm. Lovely, beautiful, and that you were able to recall the sinking feeling into that. Yeah. Beautiful. That's lovely. Oh, thank you for that, Helen. Okay, cool. Thank you. So we'll come back again. So one of the things that we often talk about are emotions. And I thought I'd just talk a little bit about emotions in terms of, I wasn't focusing there on emotions, but I was registering where there was pleasure coming in. And when there was something that was just a good experience. And that's where we hold or align with the counter vortex. So we're in the vortex of healing when we're moving towards any bit of ease or pleasure, or being able to lean into something, or being more curious about something, or discovering a new sense. All of that, in a way, is around emotion. It's what links our body and our mind. But it is often also a kind of a hesitation about emotion, you know, especially if we're in a very difficult circumstances, we may be afraid of being overwhelmed by emotion. So I'm going to talk a little bit about emotion, if that's okay with you. Yeah. Right. Is that okay, the image there? Yeah. There is no change from darkness to light, from inertia to movement, without emotion. That's from Jung, 1938. You have to be in the emotion to learn how to regulate it in a new way. Talking about it is not enough. Now that's important. You have to be in the emotion. And sometimes we're so in it, we can't talk about it. Like that client who was with the supervisee and who could not speak at all. But they're in the emotion, as it were. They may not even be able to talk at all about it. They may be just in it. But we're going to help find ways to support people to be in the emotion, not to be constricted in it, but to be able to move through it. When we're even a little bit resourced, like all three people, Raymond and Helen and Olena, you were resourced in terms of that work. When we're a little resourced even, we can track emotions or body sensations, images, and even resonance. Internally, the connection forms, which over time begins to form an embodied core sense of self. You become more and more embodied in this kind of engagement somatically. We feel less isolated and more able to receive what's around us. When people heal together, that's when the real healing begins. The more people are regulated, the more emotional space they can hold for others. Now that's really important for us as therapists, but also for us working together with groups, that the group supports each other. And somebody could hardly breathe in the session yesterday, and I did some work and we stayed again with that exhale for a little bit. The whole session changed. And people who at the end, when they got to speak, when everybody got their turn, somebody at the end said, oh, I was in a terrible state of grief when we began. But when this person, when I watched that person working with the breath, and they were doing some of the voo sounding, you can make that sound voo on the exhale as short as you like or as long as you like. They said, by the end of the breathing, I was much more at ease with what had happened. And I'm feeling okay now. And they had begun the session in a great state of loss and grief for somebody, and anger as well for somebody who had died. So the whole group healing together is very important. Very, very important. Doing things together in a group, tracking one another's sensations, emotions, when we're working and being with the other person, something really helpful happens. The connection begins to help that energy to move as well, where the new third can come in then. And it might come in with laughter, it might come in with an image, might come in with an emotion people are feeling, or there may be a gesture. Somebody might say, I just feel like that, spreading out their arms like that. So all the different ways that the communication is happening, where we're aligning with coherence, we're expanding the emotion to different parts of the body. When I did the exercise, I said, feeling the breath, being with the rhythm of the breath. And then I said, now notice the rest of your body. See how that's doing with it. And when we do that, we have more space for the emotion. We have more space for experience. We are expanding our capacity, and we're inviting all of the body to be involved, not just the tiny bit of the body where the pain is or where the constriction is, but we're inviting spaciousness and openness and involvement by the rest of the body. Naming it attainment, that's one of Dan Siegel's phrases. Putting words on something is important. It differentiates the feeling from the image, from the sensation, from the meaning. And differentiation is really, really helpful to become more embodied in ourselves. What happens when you see the image? What do you notice when you pay attention to the image? What happens in your body? They may not be able to go to their body, but they may be able to say, I don't feel so bad. How do you know that? Oh, well, I'm noticing I'm smiling. Great. Super. Even that little attention, the just noticeable difference to a little bit of attention is helpful. Separating things, I was saying that, beliefs and emotions and thoughts from the underlying sensation. Some people can come in sometimes and they're just knocked out by something that's happened and they feel sick in their stomachs. But help to differentiate rage from helplessness or terror. You try and figure out what the states are in these different places rather than being swept away and feeling drowning them. I like this from Naveen, who says, we need to go underneath the overwhelming emotion, touch into the physical sensation. And when we do that, something quite profound happens. There's a coming home. We're landing in ourselves. We come home to ourselves. Yeah. I'm going to come out of that now. And in these few minutes that are, well, I've got another, I don't know what it is, about 10 minutes or so now to just work another little bit with some demos. And this time I'm going to work, I think, Neil, you have the list there?
I do. I present you Nishma.
Thank you. Nishma. Great. Super. So Nishma, what we're going to do, we're not going to do the orienting exercise, but I'm going to invite you to work with a dream image. Is that good?
Yes.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. So I'm not going to be working in the classical Jungian way, doing the arc of the dream and the whole story of the dream. I'm just working with image because we're trying to get and set up the somatic field as part of the exploration of the dream and to see how the somatic field supports us to stay with the dream. Just as when we were doing the orienting, we stayed with whatever it is we were looking at, something happened there. What did you orient towards when you did that work, Nishma? What did you?
I oriented towards a crystal. It's kind of a smoky looking crystal.
Okay.
That it's been there for a week or so and I haven't really paid attention, and then today it caught my eye.
Good. And it's smoky looking.
Mm-hmm.
Good.
Yeah.
Where are you, Nishma? Where are you based?
I'm in Atlanta, Georgia.
Okay, super. Thank you. All right. Do you want to tell us about your dream image?
Bit disturbing. The dream image is of a baby elephant that ran out of a forest and kind of got stuck in a muddy clay patch. And then there was a tree that fell on it that was pinning it down and starting to crush it.
And starting to crush it. Okay. So just for now, tell me, what's the feeling as you're telling us the dream image?
I feel a bit panicky. I feel panicky in my chest. I feel my heart is starting to beat a little faster.
Right. Yeah. And is there a particular part of the dream image that you're feeling, you know, that you feel that panic comes in with.
The distress, because I was aware of, in the dream, I was looking at this elephant and I was aware of its distress and its inability to get away. And I also, the tree was too big for me to pick up. So I have the sense of a tree on this elephant's spine, pinning it down. And I'm noticing tension in my shoulders as well. I feel like they're a little bit lifted and maybe a bit higher than normal.
Great, you're noticing that, yeah. The tensions in your shoulders and in your chest. There's a panicky feeling. Yeah. So is this a good moment to orient? So
yes.
To work with the deactivation, yeah? Now, are you happy to go back? Was your experience with your crystal a good one earlier?
Yes.
You're curious about it to go back and have a look at it?
I found something else.
Oh, good. Let's see.
That just caught my eye.
Yeah. What's that?
It's a little purple elephant.
Oh.
It's a little wax candle of an elephant sitting on its haunches with its. It's so cute. It's so cute.
Right. It's so cute. It's sitting on its haunches. Yeah. Yeah. See what happens when you say that. It's so cute.
It's so cute and it's quite safe and it seems happy and playful, and it has these big ears that seem open to things, to new information or sounds. And it's purple.
And it's purple.
It's a little purple elephant.
Ah, you're enjoying that. That's lovely.
Yeah.
You love the purple. You think it's the purple's making you laugh?
Well, something is.
Something's making you laugh about this fella.
Yeah.
Yeah. Do you notice? What do you notice in your body with the laughter?
I can breathe again.
Yeah, that was a bit of a sigh. That was nice. Oh, great. Okay, so it's restoring the breath for you a bit of ease.
Yes.
Yeah, just noticing that breath coming back in. Yeah.
It feels like magic.
It feels like magic.
Cool. It feels like magic.
So I wonder from this place where there's a bit of magic happening and there's a breath, what's it like to see the dream from here?
There's a little more distance and I feel compassion instead of panic.
Okay.
Like something is happening.
Right.
And it's there, but I don't feel pressured in the way that I was feeling.
Good. What are you noticing now with that? Not feeling so pressured. What does that feel like?
Feels like there's space to think about something.
Good.
There's not.
There's space to think about something.
Not a pressure to act, not a overwhelming of feeling something.
Mm-hmm.
You know, feeling the pain that this creature is in, but just being able to see it. And know that something is happening. And maybe I can go find help instead of thinking, you know, that I'm stuck or that it is stuck.
So you can be more mobilized in a way. You can move.
I can move.
You're enough.
I can
move. You're enough. Yeah. Yeah. What does that feel like? You're not stuck. You can move.
I feel more present. I feel present. I don't feel kind of lost in space trying to figure something out that I can't do on my own. I feel like I can look around and look for help.
I can look around. I can look for help. Great. So if we're thinking about it in terms of the dream, there's the dream, the part of you, you could say that is this part that's underneath this huge big trunk of tree that's come down and that is immobilized. But through the dream work of the body, it's brought in some ease in terms of mobility, choice, action, sense of,
yeah.
You know, what we say about the body dreaming is like what Jung says about the dream, that it's we're dreaming the dream on. That's what he says with active imagination. So we're dreaming the dream on. There's more of you available. You're not caught in that, we could say, nervous system response, which is often the first response with a dream image as we go into our default positions, fight, flight, freeze, and we're caught in that. And it's like, you know, the rabbit in front of the headlights. Yeah. But there's some ease here with that. I think it was the fella over there in purple that got you laughing. It shook things up a bit. It just shook something up for you, that laughter.
Yeah, it did.
It did. Yeah. What happens when you look back at him now?
It just makes me chuckle.
Great.
Thank you.
Chuckle. Yeah. You're welcome. Thank you, Nishma. That's lovely. Okay, so I'm going to begin to bring this to a close because we're going to come into question and answer shortly. Just to say, really, what's central to the work, as I said at the beginning, was this alignment with the self, aligning with the self as a self-regulatory principle that's working in everything in our universe. Whether it's that purple elephant of Nishma, or whether it's the megalithic tomb in Newgrange, or whether it's the leaf, the formation of the leaf, or the spider web, there's something there's a coherence in things that we can, if we can lean into that side, more spaciousness, more capacity to think, to move, to have an option, can begin to come in. And so we have greater capacity for presence. And I want to say thank you to all the people who volunteered, Nishma and Helen and Raymond. And I'm not sure I'm getting everybody there now, in case I didn't, excuse me. Olena, beg your pardon. So thank you very much. And over to you. I think is it Catherine is taking us now?
Yes.
Thank you, Catherine.
Thank you, Marian. And thank you, Elena, for really wonderful talks with beautiful images. And they've given us a lot to think about. So now we come to the question and answers section of the webinar this evening. And I'm going to be joined by Maxim Ilyashenko as well. Who's going to read questions out from any questioners who've put questions in Ukrainian. Please do put your questions in the question and answer section. Unfortunately, we're not able to unmute people and have you speak to us, but please do put them in the question and answer section. So I think there's a couple there already. So someone has asked a question, and I think it's probably to Marian, but I think it would apply to both Marian and Elena. How do you work with someone who's experiencing chronic physical pain? Maybe Marian wants to speak to that first, and Elena might have some thoughts as well.
Chronic physical pain. I think one of the things I did in the exercise there with you was noticing where the breath was in one area and then going to the other area from you know, how's the rest of your body doing? So I think it's really important to bring in a bigger canvas than just isolating where the symptom is. So I'm holding all the time for the counter vortex. And if the symptom is very strong, like physical pain, it may be that the way through to regulation may not be through sensation at all, because the body may be the place that has suffered tremendously and so isn't available in some ways. So it may come through, it could come through image, for instance, or it may come through emotion, or it may come through gestures that I see somebody. And when I say what may come through, the regulating factor, as it were, the difference, you know, like when we worked with Nishma, the elephant, that image was able to take her into conversation, and the conversation eased the panic that she felt from the dream image. Well, in many ways, what you'd be working with symptom is, where can I find the ease? Ease in conversation, maybe ease about a dream image, or maybe ease about a memory, or you're looking and you're listening for the quality of ease. It may be a repetitive movement that's happening. Like I seem, I have a ring on my finger and I'm turning the ring. And you might say, I'm noticing you're turning your ring. Is that giving you some comfort? And in drawing attention to that, I'm building a resource for the person, a place where they can come back to and feel resourced, where they're not overwhelmed. That's what I would say.
Thank you. Olena, do you have any thoughts about cold water swimming and chronic physical pain?
In order to enter cold water, a person needs time to get used to that very idea. I mean, you need to reach internal consent. And of course, you need to have your goodwill to do that. For that, you need time, or sometimes people just find themselves there. Sometimes, quite unexpectedly, we may discover that some patients used to try this practice or somehow had some other form of interest, maybe contemplated, planned using this practice. And then it is easy, of course, to proceed with that. I mean, it depends also on whether there is a diagnosis. Because if we speak about cold swimming, you need to be very attentive, of course. If there are some systemic diseases like hypertension, where people need to take in medicines on a regular basis, or they have medical follow-up, they need to be very cautious. And maybe you need to start with swimming in summer, where the water temperature is warm, maybe body temperature, the same as body temperature. And then you can start going after this pace of the nature. By and by, you can go down, go lower with the temperature. But it needs to happen gradually. And you need to observe how the body responds to these lower temperatures. It should be a dialogical process. And if that happens with the follow-up and with in parallel with our work in the therapy room, I also work with images, with an image that helps us develop a dialogue with the pain, because pain has a voice and the voice says something. And the language speech of the image may be about, maybe expressed through drawing or sand work or an object, as Marian suggested. So it needs to happen gradually. That's my key idea, I believe. If it is chronic pain, of course, you work gradually, step by step.
Thank you. I don't know whether we've got any questions yet in Ukrainian.
No, I don't see so far.
So,
but I have a question to Olena, if
yes.
I may.
Go ahead.
Olena, I really liked your idea when you suggested water as a healing symbol or a connecting symbol between trauma and the body. I started thinking about dreams of some of my traumatized clients and water in their dreams. I didn't think about that in that perspective previously. Could you share this experience? Maybe you worked with this dreams when water appears as a healing element, maybe in the context of swimming, or maybe just a guiding image. I understand what you mean. Well, water is a very diverse symbol. However, in the dreams of our patients, we can see water of different quality. It may be clean and fresh and living, or it may be muddy, when there are a lot of dark or dead objects in the water. Sometimes water subsides, and then you see, one sees bodies, dead bodies of animals on the shore. And then you kind of can see the landscape of the trauma in this image. I've encountered the inundation, overwhelming floods in the dreams of my patients. And of course, this is about anxiety or about very intense experience or emotions that overwhelm the mind. And also, speaking about the Ukrainian tradition of the day of baptizing by water, this is our last holiday in the series of Christmas holidays. This is where people go to in winter to the water, and they are supposed to dive three times. The temperature is, of course, very low. In our culture, that is a ritual where they believe that all the sins are washed off the person. This is like cleansing ritual, and that may also appear in dreams in the same perspective.
Thank you. So we don't have all that much time left, so I wondered if we could answer questions a little bit more succinctly, briefly. But there was another question saying, how do you work with someone who cannot pay attention to their breath without entering a state of panic and has been unable to do so for decades? Marian, that might be to you, I think.
Yeah. I mean, I think what I'm trying to really bring across is, how do we lessen overwhelm? And very often you don't go for the terrible symptom. You work back from there. And so you're finding ease, you're finding safety. And that's where you're really supporting the system to trust the work, to trust itself. And when the body begins to have a sense of its own capacity expanding, being able to appreciate, take in, receive, something begins to shift. And then you may notice that they've taken, they may have sighed. You may notice that that was a deeper breath. You might not want to pay attention as the therapist, draw attention to it immediately, because you don't want the body to retreat again. So you're always making relationship to the body very gently and with great respect. So if you're noticing that the breath is shifting, you may ask the question, do you notice anything happening now? So you're bringing it back to the person's ability to pay attention and to notice little differences. And all we're looking for at any point is the just noticeable difference. Because by paying attention to it, we increase the energy around it and it supports it. But we don't want to bring it into a shame. We want to bring it into an encouragement, but very gently. And, sometimes the body doesn't want too much light on it. So if breath is the issue, I may not go there for quite some time. And it'll come in its own way. It's the autonomic system is autonomic. It just turns on given the right support. Yeah. Thank you, Kathy.
There's a question here for Olena. Would Olena recommend cold water swimming for people with autoimmune disorders? Do you have any thoughts about that?
That's an interesting question, by the way, because there are different types of autoimmune diseases and different severity and actually of different etiology. And so for some people it works, for some it does not. If we speak about disorders of functioning of a certain bodily system, well, actually we need to speak about particular cases, case by case. I can hardly give you a general answer because there are two scenarios where in some cases it works fine. For example, when there are problems with the thyroid gland, but there is another disease. I forgot the name of the disease. So there is, this is the problem with the thyroid gland. And there, yes, you can do cold water swimming and the effect is good. But if it is complicated diabetes case, for example, then I would not take the risk. So it requires time to consider that.
Yeah. We only have a few more minutes left. It would be really nice to have some questions from Ukrainian colleagues. If anyone wants to put anything in the Q&A, that would be great. But in the meantime, there's a question here from Marian. Does one need specific training before one, as an analyst, can propose body dreaming to a patient?
I would not suggest that you would have to have a training as an analyst to do that. I mean, I would suggest reading my book as the basis to understand the context. And also it slows down, gives you the information about how we do things and why we do things. So one of the things I did with the book was, first of all, I approached it by spending a lot of time going over my sessions that had happened, transcripts, and then saying, why did I do that? What was I doing there? What did I notice was happening? And what was the intervention? So that really helps, I feel, the reader to understand why I make the interventions and when I make the interventions. But I also did a chapter on how the brain works, and the information there really helps educate the analyst or the therapist, or the reader, I should say, really, why we're doing how the brain works and how the body-brain connection, the body-mind connection works. So you're working from a top-down, we say, perspective, where the neocortex is informing us why we're doing things. And we're also seeing from a bottom-up what happens when I bring the interventions in. So I would say definitely get started in bringing the body in. Just even that simple exercise of orienting can change sessions dramatically. Thank you. Great question.
And one very brief last question, I think. Would one work with an extrovert sensate type different from an introvert feeling type? We've only got 1 minute for that question.
Will I take that? Olena, would you like to take that?
That's a very curious question. I think that extroverted people, if they enter the water, they will just shout out loud. And introverted people, they will be more restrained. That's obvious. But otherwise, of course, they get the experience that can further be processed in therapy room. Marian, I believe I'll pass over to you.
Okay. Catherine, will I give it a blast?
Very briefly.
Okay. I think working with the body is working from perspective of sensation, emotion, gesture, voice, meaning, and emotion. And I think we filter these through, whether we're extroverted or introverted, in our own particular way. And both of them, I think the whole purpose really of the work is about integration. And I think I had somebody say to me yesterday, only in the group that I'm doing, the supervision group with the Ukrainian people, one person said, this work is bringing all four functions of the Jungian model together. It's very integrative work. And I think that's because it's top down and bottom up to each individual that you're working with.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
You're welcome. It was a great pleasure.
So it just remains for me to thank both speakers on behalf of everyone here for their very rich and stimulating talks this evening, and for showing us ways to work with the body and engage more with it in the therapy process. You can, of course, watch this talk and any of our other webinars again on the ARIS website, as ARIS have kindly agreed to hold all our talks. You may know already, but all our With Ukrainian Jungian speakers give generously of their time for free to nourish us and build an international community, and of course, to raise vitally important funds for our Ukrainian colleagues. Over 40 Ukrainian Jungians have applied for assistance so far. So if you've not already done so, I would encourage you to donate generously towards each of the seminars you attend. We rely completely on your donations to help our Ukrainian colleagues, and the links to the GoFundMe site are on the flyers and on the Zoom chat. Many thanks again to Marian and Olena, and now I'll hand back to Catherine Cox.
Thank you, Catherine, and a heartfelt thank you to everyone who in any way helped with this webinar, including those who were prepared to participate in a demo but weren't called upon. I'm sorry about that. A lot of very hard work takes place behind the scenes, and I'm sorry that there isn't time to thank you all individually. Thank you also to the London analyst who sponsored this webinar. It currently costs £152 to run each webinar. That's the Zoom license and that sort of stuff. We raise this money separately so as not to take anything away from the donations to our Ukrainian colleagues. So if anyone would like to sponsor a webinar, please contact us. So far, we have sponsorship for 10 of the 16 webinars, so six to go. Our gathering next month will be on 25th of April. Our presenters will be Lionel Corbett and Elena Pozdieva. And the theme will be Jung's notion of the self, an emerging new God image, very appropriate for Eastertide. On which subject, as you may know, With Ukrainian Jungians is running an image project with ARAS, which is based in the United States. If you ever feel down, in need of inspiration or centering, or just enjoy beautiful images, I recommend you take a look at the WJ Gallery on ARAS's website. You'll find the link on our flyers. The point I'm getting to is that ARAS has kindly agreed to compile a slideshow for the next webinar for when people arrive. We have all, I think, really enjoyed the previous slideshows, which have been very moving, and you can see those on the ARIS website. As the next webinar follows on from Easter in Ukraine, we thought we would take the theme of rebirth and renewal, which seems very appropriate for this project. Now, everyone is invited to contribute to the slideshow. Now, Ukraine has a wonderful tradition of icons, stunning traditional icons, but also a thriving art scene of contemporary icons. Now, I know this because I have to confess that I love icons. I can look at them for hours. So we wondered if our Ukrainian colleagues, and indeed anyone else, would like to share pictures of icons from your homes or your communities. We would really love to see them. But it doesn't have to be icons. I know that's not everybody's thing. So we would also very much like contributions from other cultures to do with rebirth and renewal, or just whatever comes up for you. Let's just all share and enrich one another with our own images of renewal and rebirth. So renewal, rebirth, icons, music, images, you can submit them all through the ARIS website, and we'll also be circulating an email address. Another big announcement that I have is to let you know that we will be holding another International Social Dreaming Matrix on September the 12th in English and Ukrainian. We have a large international team of highly experienced conveners already confirmed. You don't need to be fluent in either language to participate. We can all help one another. Those of you who came to the Anne Ulanov event and participated in the six parallel matrices that we held then may recall what an extraordinary, although not always easy, event that was. As far as we know, that was the first time a matrix like that had been attempted. And I can honestly say that it changed me, and it was a major factor in the emergence of with Ukrainian Jungians. So more details to follow in due course, but please put 12th of September in your diaries. I think it'll be a very special event. And I have one final piece of news, and I don't know whether Neil is ready with his spotlight. I'm going to embarrass our new project coordinator, Jackie Fisher. Are you able to put Jackie on briefly there? Thank heavens that some help has arrived. Jackie comes to us with a wealth of experience managing projects in the third sector. Now, I suspect that she's currently feeling like she's been hit by a bus, but I have no doubt that she will get on top of things and provide us with much needed organization and structures shortly. And I would really like to acknowledge Jackie's considerable generosity in taking this on. It will be many hours of work unpaid to start with. And so please do join me in welcoming Jackie and in thanking her.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. And to our Ukrainian colleagues and anyone else at risk, we pray that you will stay safe, and we look forward to seeing everyone again next month. And as we depart and say goodbye to one another, we're going to play the prayer for Ukraine again. Thank you, everyone, and good night.